Meet the Press with Paul Bongiorno.
Hello and welcome to Meet the Press. For the Prime Minister, it was a 50-minute stare-down, a stellar performance, taking on the lunar right and the mainstream media, inviting 21 senior gallery journos to catch her out. We didn't. Julia Gillard likened the recycling of the two-decade-old murmurings against her over a union slush fund to claims President Obama was not an American and was a Muslim.
I know that there's going to be a segment of people for which, no matter what we put out, this issue will not be put to rest.
Will the misogynists and the nut jobs on the internet continue to circulate them? Yes, they will.
We're not going to be able to solve our problems if we get distracted by sideshows and carnival barkers.
This is not reason, it's not facts, this eccentric lunar right Tea Party style interventions that we're seeing in our politics.
We do not have time for this kind of silliness.
And there's nothing that a person of reason can do to deal with it. The best thing I think you can do is just ignore it.
We've got big problems to solve, and I'm confident we can solve them, but we're going to have to focus on them. Not on this.
If we're all in, all done, and we'll take a question on the nation's economic future.
And key to that future, the lifespan of the resources boom undermined by BHP's shelving of the giant Olympic Dam project in South Australia.
The commodity price boom is over. Anyone in half a brain knows that.
We're going to maximise the chances of this project going ahead by abolishing the carbon tax, abolishing the mining tax.
Workplace Relations Minister Bill Shorten meets the press. And later, educator Dr. Kevin Donnelly doubts the Gonski School funding plan. And you can follow the conversation on Twitter at hashtag MTP10. But first, Emily Rice has what's making news this Sunday, August 26.
Thanks, Paul. Good morning. US astronaut Neil Armstrong, the first man to walk on the moon, has died at the age of 82. The commander of the Apollo 11 mission became a global hero when he made one giant leap for mankind with a small step onto the moon in July 1969. He had recently undergone heart bypass surgery. The Country Liberal Party has swept Labor from power in the Northern Territory. The CLP, led by Terry Mills, ended 11 years of Labor rule with a swing of more than 6%. The CLP won 14 seats, Labor 8, with 2 undecided. Their victory was driven by a backlash in the bush thanks to an historically strong Indigenous vote. Outgoing Chief Minister Paul Henderson was gracious in defeat.
Tonight, Territorians have spoken and I respect their decision.
The CLP's Terry Mills pledged to govern for all the people in the NT.
We will bring the territory together again. One territory.
But it was better luck for Labor in Sydney, winning the by-election in Christina Keneally's seat of Heffron with a strong performance against the Greens. And a female zookeeper has been mauled to death by a Siberian tiger at a zoo in Germany after the animal escaped its enclosure. It was shot dead by the zoo's director. And those are the top stories this morning. Paul.
Thanks, Emily. And it's welcome back to the program, Bill Shorten. Good morning, Minister.
Good morning, Paul.
Well, another Labor government has fallen. The remaining Labor governments, including the federal one, on death row?
Oh, I wouldn't characterise it that way at all. I feel for Mr Henderson. I know he's a very committed Northern Territorian. I congratulate Mr Mills, the new leader of the Northern Territory. I've been speaking to people this morning in the Northern Territory and said, what's your explanation? What do you think's happened? They've said that there were local government reforms which went down very badly in the bush. Mr Henderson thought that the suburbs of Darwin were where the debate was going to be, and he did very well there. So it's a story of two elections in the Northern Territory, Darwin and the bush, and in the bush, the Northern Territory local government reorganisations had a big effect. The other thing which sources up there tell me is that still a little bit of residual resentment over the federal government intervention. So I think it's a very important election, but
so
I'm not sure.
So it's not a reflection on the Labor brand?
No, I suspect it's a reflection on local politics. It's the story of two elections in the Territory, Darwin and the bush. It's a story of local government amalgamations. There are people disgruntled by that.
So from that, you would say federal Labor under Julia Gillard still has a chance of winning the next election?
Yes, we do still have a chance of winning the next election.
That doesn't seem to be a view held by all of your colleagues in federal parliament this weekend. Both Fairfax and News Limited papers have pointed to the speech made by Robert McClelland as reopening this 20-year-old issue with Julia Gillard, the AWU, Slater and Gordon. Are there rats in the ranks determined to undermine Julia Gillard?
No, I believe that the caucus wants to see Labor do well. I know that the Prime Minister has the support of the caucus. The issues which happened 20 years ago were difficult then, but I think that the caucus this week thought that the Prime Minister, in face of quite a tough attack, more than held her own with that hour-plus long press conference on Thursday. So I think we've ended the week on a better note than perhaps we even started it.
So if it was a plan to destabilise her, it's backfired?
The worst thing in the world we can start doing is analysing ourselves. I think what people want in Australia is to say, well, are we going to do our national disability insurance scheme? Are we committed to doing better in education? I also think people want the opposition to explain how they are going to fund their policies. Yesterday we saw the university cuts proposed by the opposition, which I think has raised a lot of eyebrows and concerns.
Well, during that press conference, the Prime Minister defended her statement that the so-called slush fund is an everyday event in unions. In other words, union leaders, democratically elected, they're perfectly legitimately able to ask for funds to help in that re-election. Is it a good look, and could that sort of slush fund still be set up 20 years later?
Well, let's be really clear on our language here and what's important. First of all, trade unions in Australia, with notable exceptions, but very few exceptions, are honestly run. There's 2 million Australians in trade unions. There's thousands of delegates and representatives trying to lift the pay, improve the safety of jobs, make sure that employees' voices get heard. The opposition have a real problem with the role of unions in our community, I think. Now, in terms of the administration of unions, they're governed by what's called the Fair Work Registered Organisations Act. It's a Labor government. In fact, it was myself as minister who's put through the toughest new standards in terms of the governance of registered organisations. That includes unions and employer associations. I don't believe it was possible back in 1995 when it came out about the misuse of this particular fund. That wasn't appropriate then, and it wouldn't be appropriate now. The real test is what's in the best interest of members, and we've put in new standards to handle that.
But can you give assurances to the Australian people, and indeed to the 2 million union members, that it's harder now to be a corrupt union official, to line your own pocket at the expense of the members and of the general public, really?
Yes, I absolutely can. First of all, and I've got a couple of reasons to support why I make that statement. First of all, we've made it clear that if you're a representative of an association, be it a union or an employer association, you have to disclose your remuneration. You now have to reveal all material personal interests. You have to reveal payments to related parties, including family members. So the standards are tougher. Okay. But I will make this point. The standards, even if they haven't been as high as they are now, have been largely honoured in the way they've been applied.
Time for a break. When we return with the panel, does the scathing KPMG audit demand a Fair Work Australia overhaul? And the macho moment of the week came when Tony Abbott recalled some schoolboy bravado with one of his teachers.
You know, Emmett, I'm so strong that I could pick you up and put you in my top pocket. And the distinguished Jesuit said, yes, and if you did that, you'd have more brains in your top pocket than you've got in your head.